Good morning, New Vision. I didn't get to get around and shake everybody's hand and all that good stuff. Good to see y'all. I know we got a lot on vacation, but man, I'm so glad you guys came. Hallelujah. Yeah, looks full from here. I got a couple things. First, Anita wanted me to announce that we're going to have a youth meeting or youth parents meeting right after church, okay? So if you've got a youth age, please come up to the front right after church. I'm going to stick this up here and maybe try to remember, but y'all know how I am. I'm one track. I got a very special guest in here. I'm going to embarrass him. Jimmy, would you stand up there, son? This is Jimmy Phillips. Everybody give him a good round of applause. That's his dad, Bill, and his stepmom, Helen. But Helen used to go to church with my mom. I just found that out this morning. And Bill, his wife passed away. She was an awesome woman. But it's good to have you guys, man. I pray that y'all just have a great service this morning. And everybody else, we got some others in here. I ain't going to embarrass them because he can whoop me. But Joe Gorman, it's good to see you and Sonya back there. Good to have y'all. All right, y'all ready for a good service? Yeah. I am ready. I'm trying to think. I don't believe I'm missing anything yet, but just want to remind you that we are doing a church normal, like on Wednesday nights and Sunday mornings. And y'all try to practice your social distancing as best you can. Don't get me in trouble. I told somebody today, I said, it might be a good day to go to jail, but, you know, I don't really want to go, but if I have to, you know. But do your best to practice social distancing. But we're going to have an awesome service. I am so ready. Y'all ready? Yeah. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord? Yeah. Come on. Hallelujah. Yeah. Woo. Yes, man. Can't keep a good church down, can you? All right. Ushers, I tell you what we're going to do. If we got any visitors, if you would, raise your hands. We've got something we want to give you. Our offering today, right up here, Miss Beth, special guest. Our offering today we're going to do just like we did last time. When you go out, you give it. That way we're not passing offering plates. We do want to be as careful as we can so that we don't, you know, just make any be foolish. You know what I'm saying? But y'all look good, man. Y'all look real good. Look at your neighbor and say, you look good. Now say, I'm going to meet you at the altar because I lied. Doc, stand up. I just seen Doc. Woo! Doc's in the house. All right. Hallelujah. Y'all slipped in on me back there. Good to have you. All right, guys, we're going to start. We're going to have a worship service, but we love you guys. We appreciate you coming. And just continue to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Amen. Through all this stuff, this is the best time to be a witness, to love on people. Man, they tripping on us. I like that, don't you? All right, let's pray. Father, we love you, we worship you, and we honor you in this place today. God, we would be amiss if we didn't recognize Memorial Day, Lord, for all those that have died for our country, fighting for our freedom, fighting for the very reason that we're in here today. What a great day we're getting to come back to church. This is what a lot of them fought for, all of them. They fought for our freedom, for our liberty, Lord. And Lord, they gave the ultimate sacrifice. They lost their lives in battle for us. And I thank you for them, Lord. We honor them today, Lord. We honor the families. My dad was a serviceman. Lord, we honor them today, God. But Lord, we honor you, Jesus. We honor you. This is your house. This is your time. This is your place. And we know that you're going to move by your Spirit, Lord. So, God, just move in here. I was thinking this morning, you know, and everybody in here probably knows this and understands this, but if we just come in here and have a service, then that's all we did was have a service. I'm going to talk about it just a little bit about religious service. But, Lord, we don't want to have a service. We want to have a relationship. We want to have a desire to see you move. And there's lives in here that need to be touched and changed. You know, the singing, Tommy's going to be singing, a worship team, and I'm going to be preaching. And, Lord, we're going to try our best to do what you've called us to do. But unless the Spirit of the living God is in this place, nothing good is going to happen. So, God, we ask you to move by your Spirit. And that every single person that's in here, every person that's listening on Facebook, that their life will be touched and changed in a way that they'll realize that it was great to be in the house of the Lord. Because, Lord, you want to move and you want to minister. And so we just let you have freedom. This is your house. We have certain things that we think we're going to do, but we don't even care, Lord. You do what you want to do. I pray that the Spirit of God will fall on our worship. And Lord, that we would truly worship you in spirit and in truth. There's freedom in this place to worship. And Lord, again, I pray that the altars would not be barren. God's people would know that anytime they can come to the altar of God and lay everything down, Lord, cast all of our care on you because you care for us. Thank you for a great day in the house of the Lord. We love you and we worship you in Jesus' precious name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Let's worship the Lord together. Amen.
While the worship team's coming, I just want to say how good it is to be in the house of God today with you guys. Let's all stand to our feet and let's give him praise. He's worthy. No matter what you think, he's worthy. No matter what you're going through, he's worthy. So let's praise him this morning. I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of a storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. And death is defeated, the King.
Let's raise our voices. Sing a little louder.
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 Let's sing a little louder.
Come on, let's sing
his
a little
word.
Louder.
Let's sing a little louder. There was a moment when the lights went out, when death proclaimed its victory. The King of love had given up his life, the darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners, for every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished, but not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake, and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roared. All hail King Jesus, all hail the Lord of heaven and earth, all hail King Jesus, all hail the Savior of the world. There was a moment when the sky lit up, a flash of light was breaking through. When all was lost, he crossed eternity. The King of life was on the move. For in a dark, cold tomb, where our Lord was laid, a miraculous breath, and we're forever changed. All hail King Jesus, all hail the Lord of heaven and earth, all all hail. voice. All hail King Jesus. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Lord of heaven and earth. All hail King Jesus. All hail the Savior of the world. Amen. He is worthy. He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. He's always right beside us.
There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire. Standing next to me was another in the waters, holding back the sea. Should I ever need reminding, I've been set free. There's a cross that bears the burden, where another died for me. There is another in the fire. There's another in the fire. All my dead left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be alone. There is another in the fire, standing next to me. There is another in the waters, holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding, what power set me free. There is a grave that holds nobody, and now that power lives in me. There is another in the fire. Whoa.
God, we ask that you remove everything between us right now. We want to see your face, Lord. Take away every distraction, God. Remove any hindrance in this room, God.
And There was no other name but the name that is Jesus. He who was and still is and will be through it all. So come with me in the space between all these things unseen and this reckoning. And I know I will never be alone. We're never alone. And I know I will never be alone. I know I'll never be alone. And I know I will never be alone. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me? I count the joy from every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. I can see, and I can see the light in the darkness as the darkness bows to him. That's where you'll be. I count the joy come every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. We'll be right back.
He wants to move in your life. He wants to move in your life. But you have to get out of the way and you have to let Him move. There's power in the name of Jesus. Right here, right now. There's power. There's power for chains to fall and fear to bow. Here, right now, Jesus, you change everything. Lives be healed, let hope be found. Right here, right now, Jesus, you change everything.
Guys, listen to me for a minute. The Spirit of God has been moving. I've been asking, you know, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do? And I feel like the Lord just wants to open up these altars. He wants you to come. He wants to minister to you. This is where the Spirit of the Lord wants to touch you. There's no use in us going through the rest of this service, singing anymore, or even preaching, because the Spirit of God is here right now. Maybe some of you've come in here and you've been broken, you've been wounded, you've been hurt, you've been backslidden. Whatever it is in your life, come down here and just let the Lord minister to you right now. The Spirit of God is in this place and He wants to move. And so we're going to allow Him an opportunity to move in your life. So whatever you've been going through, maybe you've been going through, you know what, for 3 months since all this stuff started, you've been fearful or you've been in anxiety or you've had other things going on. Maybe you just got away from the Lord. This is the time to come. As we can, I want them to continue to sing this. I want to send Susie to minister through this song. But I want you to come and let the Holy Spirit move in your life. This is your chance. You know, I've been wondering. I've been praying about the altars. Y'all know that I prayed that the altars would not be barren. And all through this whole time, I said, Lord, may the altars of their houses not be barren. Maybe you just need to come down and just make a fresh commitment to the Lord. Maybe come down and give your children, your family back to the Lord. Whatever it is that you need to do, this is the time to do it. Don't be afraid. Nobody's going to bother you. Nobody's going to hurt you. Come to this altar. Let's make things right. And let's just do this. The Spirit's moving. There's no use in going any further. Let Him minister. That's what I want this worship team to do, is to minister to this congregation, to speak life over this congregation. So just come and let the Lord move in your life. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
In wonder and surrender we fall down.
Thank you,
Jesus. Show us your glory.
Come on, church, press in.
Show us your glory.
Press in, He's here.
Let every burning heart be holy ground.
Cast all your care on Him because He cares for you.
Show us your glory.
Hallelujah.
Pastor Scott mentioned earlier, we were talking about Memorial Day, and man, I honor those that died for our freedom and our liberty in this country, but man, our Lord died for our freedom on this earth, not just in this country, but freedom. Break free from what's holding you today. There is power within you because of Him to break free from your chains and to walk in that liberty and to walk in victory and to be an overcomer. Chains fall, fear bow here now. Jesus, you change everything. Lives healed, hope found here now. Jesus, you change everything. To change everything, I'm here at home. It's right here, right now. Oh, Jesus, you change everything. Oh, you change it all, Lord. Because of you, because of you, we're never the same, Lord.
Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, come silence every fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, your name, 'cause your name is light that the shadows can't deny, and your name cannot be overcome, and your name is alive, forever lifted high, and your name cannot be overcome. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. We give you glory this morning, Lord, 'cause you're worthy. You're so worthy. Oh, you're deserving all our praise. Give it to him, church. 'Cause yours is the kingdom and yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever. Amen. And yours is the kingdom and yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever. Amen. Yours is the kingdom and yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever. Amen. Yours is the kingdom and yours is the power. Darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus. You silence fear, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, we can do better than that. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. You're worthy, Lord. All the glory belongs to you, Lord. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. We lift up a shout of triumph in this place, Lord, because you alone are worthy to be praised in this place, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. You're worthy to be praised in this place. You're worthy to be praised in this place, Lord. In Jesus' name, not by power, not by might, but your spirit, Lord. Yes, let's sing it again. Woo! Lord, Lord. Lord, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You said that you don't dwell in a tabernacle anymore, but beside you dwell in us. We are the tabernacle that you house your spirit in. We are the tabernacle of the most holy God, the most high God. You're living inside of us, the same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in our mortal bodies. Why should we be afraid of anything? Lord Jesus, yours is the kingdom. This is your kingdom. You're in control. You're in authority. Nothing happens unless you allow it. You're it. We trust you, Lord. We trust you, Lord. Praise you for being who you are. Praise you for being faithful. Praise you for doing what you said you would do, Lord. We honor you in this place. Thank you for the move of your spirit. God, touch lives, change hearts, Lord. Make us more like you. There's not a one of us in here that's arrived yet. We all need to be touched by your spirit, Lord. Fill us afresh, Lord. Fill us afresh, Lord. I need a fresh dose of the Holy Ghost is what I need. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for stirring us, Lord. Thank you for stirring us, Lord. You've been stirring me all morning. I give you praise, Lord, for moving by your spirit, for doing a work that only you can do. You're going to do it, Lord. Revival's coming. Revival's coming. A move of God is coming. We receive it and believe it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Lord, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It's just awesome to be in your house, to be with our family, to feel your, feel your presence. Like you can cut it with a knife, thick. And I praise you for it, Lord. God, I pray for every person that's in here, Lord, that all of us at different levels in our spiritual walk. But God, I pray that you'd help us, Lord, to stir up the gift that's within us, Lord, to move and to do the things that you've called us to do. The time is short. Time is short. God, we got to be about your business. Help us to seize every opportunity. Help us to be filled with your spirit, filled with your word, filled with prayer, filled with power, so we can do what you've called us to do, Lord. Help us to be sensitive to the move of God, Lord. We give you praise for moving by your spirit. Thank you for the word you've given me. God, let your word go forth with power and boldness. Let it accomplish what you want it to accomplish, to set us free and to cause us to be more like you. In Jesus' precious name. And all God's people said, amen. You can sit down if you can. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. That's good stuff. Man, it's so good to be back in the house of the Lord. I'm excited about being back in the house of the Lord. There's a lot of people that wasn't here last week, and so I want to just give you a little bit of background. If you would, go to 1 Samuel, and we're going to start in chapter 2, but I want to give you a little bit of background. The children of Israel were falling away from God. The priests were not doing what they were supposed to do. The high priest, his name was Eli, and Eli was serving the Lord. It says he served the Lord for over 40 years, but he had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, and they were snakes in the grass. Amen? They were wicked priests, and they were doing all kind of wickedness in the temple. I'm talking about where the presence, where the ark of the God, where the ark of God was, where the tent of meeting was. They was doing all kind of wickedness. You can go back and study it, but because of a mixed crowd, I'm going to chill out this week and not be x-rated. Hallelujah. And all the grown-ups said, amen. But they were doing some wicked stuff at the temple. And so God is getting ready to judge that. And I want you to understand this. And I parallel this with America. You know, America was, what is it? In God we trust. I mean, they were built on the fundamentals of the Bible and Christian nation. But America has forsaken God, man. Sin has come rampant in America, in the United States. And if you can't see it, you're blind. I'm just being honest with you. Sin is everywhere. The devil is rampant. He's trying to destroy families. He's trying to destroy churches. He's trying to destroy everything he can before Jesus comes back. But I want to tell you, I've been telling y'all the whole time, the move of God is coming. God's church is not going out with their tail between their legs. We're going out in victory when Jesus comes back. Amen? Right. Hallelujah. So anyway, I've always told y'all there's a payday coming. There's a payday to sin. I mean, my mama used to tell me all the time, son, you reap what you sow. Be sure your sins will find you out. And this is what's happening. So the children of Israel, they would bring the sacrifices, and Eli and Hophni and Phinehas, his two sons, would steal the sacrifices. They'd do all kind of crazy stuff. So I want to pick up at verse 27. And I want you to hear me. There is nobody expendable in the kingdom of God. God doesn't want to take anybody away. He didn't want to pull anybody's authority. He don't want to pull anybody back from what they're doing. But I'm telling you, God will only allow things to go along so long. And I'll be honest with you, I can't believe that more judgment hadn't come on America than what has. I mean, he's staying his hand, I believe, because of the prayers of the saints. That's just my opinion, okay? But I want you to look at verse 27. In chapter 2, verse 27, and the title of my message, you know, I've been preaching through a series. It's called "The Ark of the Covenant Has Been Captured, Has Been Taken." And I want you to understand that the Ark of the Covenant was where God's physical presence was. Okay, now the Holy Spirit is everywhere. He lives inside of us. We're the tabernacle. We're the temple. We house His presence. But back then, it was in one place, and it's called Shiloh. And that's where the house of God was, the temple of God. And this is where all this wickedness had taken place. Okay? So I want you to look at verse 27. It says, now, if you go back, in verse 23 through 26, Eli had confronted his sons and told them what they was doing was wrong. Okay, so I'm going to talk about that a little bit more. It says, a man of God came to Eli. God's always got a man that's going to speak the truth. He might have to look a long time to find him, but he's got a man that's going to speak the truth. It says, the Lord says, I made myself clearly known to your relatives who lived long ago. I did it when they were in Egypt under Pharaoh, when they were in bondage. I made myself clear to them. He said, I chose your father Aaron to be my priest. Notice this. He said, I chose him out of all the tribes of Israel. I told him to go up to my altar. I told him to burn incense. I chose him to wear a linen apron when he served me. I also gave his family all the offerings that are made with fire by the people of Israel. You notice how personal God made this? God said, I'm the one that done it. Eli, I don't want you to be mistaken about this. I'm the one that chose your father. I'm the one that told your father what to do. I'm the one that set this up. So he's telling him, I'm responsible for all this. So when you sin against God, when you do this sin, you're sinning against me, God. He said, I'm the one that set this up. Y'all with me? And then God says this to him through the man of God. He said, why do all of you laugh at my sacrifice and offerings? The King James says, why do you kick? Or why do you disgrace? Why do you trample underneath your feet my sacrifices and offerings? He said, I'm the one that set it up. Aaron didn't set it up. Moses didn't set it up. I set it up. Why are you trampling what I set up underneath your feet? And that's what the King James says if you study that word out. He says, why do you laugh? Why do you all laugh at my sacrifice and my offering? He said, I require them to be brought to the house where I live. That's where he stayed. He said, I require that. He said, why do you honor your sons more than me? He said, why do you honor your sons more than me? Why do you let your sons continue to do what they're doing? I'm going to preach a little bit about it in a minute. He said, why do you honor your sons more than me? And church family, you need to listen to this. You better not honor your children before God. Oh boy, I could preach there and throw a fit. Guys, children are not supposed to run the house. You're supposed to run the house. The reason the world's in the shape it is today is because the parents in the last 20 years have fallen down on what God says you're supposed to do and how God says you're supposed to raise a family, and God's going to judge America because our families have done that. Now that made half of you mad. Look at your neighbor and say, he's just getting started. He said, why do all you laugh? And then he goes down, he says, why have you honored your sons and your daughter or your sons more than me? He said, why do you fatten yourselves on the best parts of every offering that is made by my people Israel? He's saying, why are you stealing what's supposed to be mine? And I could preach there for about 2 hours too. Anytime you take what's God, you're stealing from God. You ain't stealing from, when you don't tithe, you ain't stealing from the church, you're stealing from God. Put that in your spiritual pipe and smoke it. We're going to go on. The Lord is the God of Israel, he announced. Now get this. I want to talk to you about this for a minute. He said, I promised that your family and the family of Aaron would serve me as priests forever. God said, I made you a promise. He said, I actually made your father Aaron a promise that your family would be the priest forever. God made that promise. He said, I made that promise. But look at what he says. But now, the Lord announces, I will not let that happen. And I want to repent to you guys, because I've quoted this many times. I said, the only thing that can stop the promises of God is you. Y'all remember me saying that? No. The only thing that can stop the promises of God is two things, you and God. God can stop his promises that he's given. And he does right here. He had promised Aaron, hey, I'm going to let you be the priest forever. And now because of their wickedness and because of their sin and because of them not listening to God, now God says, okay, now I'm not going to do it. I'm pulling back on my promise to you. He says, but now the Lord announces, I will not let that happen. I will honor those who honor me, but I will turn away from those who look down on me. Boy, I've read a lot of scriptures, but this scripture right here, boy, God ain't playing. God is not playing. He's not fooling around. He's saying, look, y'all better get this right. He said, you done messed up. Now, you done made me mad. And I sure don't want to make God mad. And then he goes on, he says this, the time is coming when I will cut your life short. I will also cut short the lives of those in your family. Listen to this. No man in your family line will grow old. Boy, God lays the hammer down. He lays the axe to the root. He says, you will see nothing but trouble in the house where I live. He said, good things will still happen to the children of Israel, but no man in your family line will ever grow old. He said, you're going to see good things happening, but it ain't because of you. He said, only thing you're going to see is trouble. Man. A member of your family will serve me at the altar, but what he does will bring tears to your eyes. Your heart will be sad, and the rest of the men in your family line will die while they are still young. All because he would not handle his children the way he was supposed to handle his children. Because he allowed sin in the house of God. Oh boy. He said, something is going to happen to your two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. Remember Hophni? It meant the one that fights with fists. And Phinehas meant the serpent's mouth. He said, something's going to happen to Hophni and Phinehas. And when it does, it will show you that what I am saying is true. They will both die on the same day. Boy, aren't you glad we live under grace right now? That don't mean God can't do what he wants to do, but I'm just saying I'm so glad that we live underneath grace right now. It says they will both die on the same day. He said, I will raise up myself a faithful priest. He will do what my heart and my mind want him to do. I will make his family line very secure. They will always serve as priests to my anointed king. God says, I'm gonna pick somebody out. You know, I chose Aaron, and he did a good job, but now you took it over. Now you've allowed your sons to corrupt it. Just one generation or one term. His grandchildren, Aaron's grandchildren, are the one that corrupted the place. And the Bible plainly says that Eli sat back and watched it. I'll hit that again in a minute. He said, everyone who is left in your family line will come and bow down to him, the priest that he's going to raise up. He said, they will beg him for a piece of silver and a crust of bread. Now, I want you to understand that God had already given him provision. He said, I gave Aaron from the sacrifices of all the children of Israel. So they were taken care of. They were rich. They were rich in everything they needed. But now he says, you're going to beg for a crust of bread and a piece of silver. Don't think you can't bring a curse on your family by not doing what you're supposed to do. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm not trying to preach damnation on you. I'm just saying, be careful that your choices and decisions you make, because it not only affects you, it affects your children and your children's children until Jesus comes back. Amen? And then he goes on, he says, they will say, please give me a place to serve among the priests. Then I can have food to eat. God had given them all this stuff, and now God's taking it back. Well, you can read later just for time's sake, but the next 11 verses, it talks about how, you remember how Hannah had brought Samuel to the house of God, and she had left him at the house of God. She had promised the Lord that she was going to bring him and let him serve. Samuel means God heard, and so Samuel's with Eli, the prophet, and so he's there, and God comes in the middle of the night. Eli had went to sleep. Samuel went to sleep. And it says that God come in the middle of the night and he calls Samuel. Samuel gets up. He hears an audible voice, man. He gets up and he runs in there to Eli, and Eli's asleep, and he wakes him up. He said, "Here I am. What do you need?" He said, "I didn't call you. Go back to bed." Second time, same thing. God calls Samuel. Samuel thinks it's Eli. He runs in there, and he gets down. He says, "Here I am. Your servant's here, Eli." And he said, "I didn't call you." And then the third time, after the third time, finally, Eli says, "Well, dang, something's up with this." He said, "Go back. It's the Lord talking to you." Because if you look at chapter 3, verse 7, it says that Samuel did not know the Lord yet. But if you notice, if you go back and you read, it says that Samuel served before the Lord. He served the Lord. But in verse 7 of chapter 3, it says he didn't even know the Lord. You know that there are people today that serve the Lord that don't even know him? I told you the great falling away isn't that people are going to quit coming to church. It's that people's going to be in church, but they ain't going to have a relationship with Jesus. They're going to be serving him, but they don't even know who they're serving. They don't have a personal relationship with Jesus. Okay, y'all can amen me anytime you want. If you don't, I'm going to preach that much harder. God comes to Samuel, and he talks to him. He speaks to him. And I want you to go to verse 11. Eli told Samuel to say, "Hear my Lord, speak. Your servant's listening." And that's exactly what Samuel said to the Lord. And in verse 11, in chapter 3, it says this: "The Lord said to Samuel," pay attention, listen to me. How many of y'all, my mama used to grab me right here and she'd say, any of y'all ever have that happen? Parents, maybe some of y'all need to learn this. Grab them by the face, make sure they look in your eyes. If my mama grabbed you and she said, "Listen to me, boy," and I looked away, I got smacked. My mama was an awesome mama. She didn't play. And he's saying, God's telling Samuel, "Listen to me." When God says that to you, what he's basically saying is, stop listening to everybody else, forget whatever else you've heard, and listen to me, because I'm going to speak something into your life. And boy, if I could say, y'all listen to me. Some of y'all need to quit listening to everybody else and start listening to God. Some of y'all need to say, "Here I am, Lord, speak to me." Don't speak to me through Pastor Scott. That's good. Don't speak to me through the worship. Don't speak to me through my Sunday school teacher. Don't speak to me through my small. Speak to me, Lord. I don't know about y'all, but I tell the Lord all that all the time. Talk to me. Speak to me. I need to hear from you. I need your help. Hallelujah. It says, "The Lord said to Samuel, pay attention. I'm about to do something terrible in Israel." Now, it says that Samuel was around 14 or 15 years old at this time. It says that he'd been serving the Lord. He'd been going through the motions. Not his fault. He'd been going through the motions, but he did not know the Lord yet. So now the Lord is speaking to him for the very first time. And it says here, he says, "I am about to do something terrible in Israel. I will make the ears of everyone who hears this ring or tremble." He says, "At that time, I will do everything Eli and his family." He said, "I will do everything to Eli and his family that I said I would. I will finish what I have started." And then here he goes again. He said, "I told Eli that I would punish his family forever." Can you imagine this young boy that's been mentored by Eli, probably looks up to Eli. Now listen, he probably saw everything. He had to see everything that was going on. But he was mentored by Eli. Eli actually called him son. And here God is telling Samuel, "I'm getting ready to punish Eli's family forever. I ain't going to give them a spanking. I'm going to punish them forever." God was serious about his offering and about the things that they did, the sacrifices that they took for granted. He said, "I told Eli I would punish his family forever." He knew, listen, y'all, he knew his sons were sinning. He knew they were making fun of me. In spite of that, he failed to stop them. Why did God get mad at Eli? It just tells you right here. Because Eli was the high priest. He was the one over the children of Israel. And God had spoken to him in the past. But if you look at the scriptures, it says the word of the Lord was scarce in the house of God. That means God wasn't speaking to him much anymore because he didn't have nobody to talk to. Oh, help me, Jesus. Maybe God ain't speaking a lot to the church because we ain't listening and he ain't got nobody to talk to. Here I am, Lord, speak to me. Amen. And it says that God was mad at them. Everybody listen. It says that God was mad at them and upset with them because, or with Eli, because he knew what his sons was doing and he did nothing about it. Now, parents, y'all need to listen to me and listen to me good, okay? I'm not Dr. Oz or what's that guy's name that thinks he knows how to parent, tells you not to spank your kids and all that stuff. Who is it? Yeah, he's a goofball. But anyway, I'm not here to tell you how to parent. You're going to stand before God for how you parent. I'm going to stand before God for how I raised Allison. Amen? But I want to tell you something. When you see your kids doing something wrong, you need to stop them. Okay? If they're grown adults and you can't stop them, and that's true, that happens. If they're out of your house and grown adults, you can't stop them. If they're in your house and they're doing things they're not supposed to do, you can stop them. It's called kick their sorry butts out. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, preacher. You're being mean now. No, listen to me. When you bring sin in your house, when you allow sin to go on in your house, it's on you. When your children leave the house and they go do things that you don't know what they're doing and stuff, then that's on them. But when you allow that sin and corruption and garbage come into your house, it is on you. You say, well, I'm not doing it. It's on you. It's your house. Men, you're the priest of your house. You better step up. Amen. You better stop allowing sin to go on in your house because you're going to pay for it. You're the priest of the house. I don't care if your wife gets mad. Bring her in here and we'll counsel with them. I'll straighten her out real fast. Hey, it's time to call a spade a spade. Eli lost his ministry. His family lost the ministry, the heritage that God had promised them. They lost it because he wasn't man enough to set his kids down. He wouldn't. I was set down. At the church we used to go to, I was set down because I did something stupid. Just because I was one of the lead singers on the worship team and everybody knew me and I did the new convert, I did all this, Shelly and Pastor Bill set my butt down. Eli should have set him down. I set my own daughter down. Oh, I'm a terrible parent. Lord, help us. It's time for us to stand up and be the people of God God's called us to be. It's time for you to stop letting junk go on in your house that you know is going on in your house that ain't supposed to go on in your house. You're going to pay for it. Enough said, right? Did everybody get that? Raise your hand if you got it. Whether you're going to listen to it or not, did you get it? Kids, do y'all understand? Oh, Lord, help me. I just saw that. Y'all are beautiful. Y'all are so pretty. But do you see the effects you can have on your parents if you don't listen? See, because he went back to him. Eli went to him and said, look, guys, what y'all doing is not right. In verse 23 in chapter 2, he said, what y'all doing is not right. You need to stop. And they didn't listen, so Eli had to pay for it. Eli served over 40 years, and I'm not going to get to it this week, but next week or the next, whenever it is, you're going to see how he had to pay for their sins. And it's terrible. All because, only thing he would have had to do was set them down. Set them down. Sit down for a little while. Get your junk together, and then you can come back. Amen. There's nothing wrong with setting people down at church. Matter of fact, it's biblical. It's not biblical to allow sin on this platform or any other platform. If you're in leadership, If you are on a worship team, or if you're preaching, or you're a Sunday school teacher, or you're a trustee, or you're a deacon, you ain't supposed to be having known sin in your life. And if you do, you need to step your tail down. I ain't saying you're perfect. None of us are perfect. We got to hold a standard in leadership. How can we expect the church to hold a standard if the leadership don't hold a standard? Well, y'all can shout me later. It's okay. Amen. I got two people that like that. That was the kids, wasn't it? Hallelujah. No, man, I'm not trying to be mean, man. I'm just saying, man, there's a standard in the house of God. Yeah, It was a standard back then in the house of God, and they broke it. They messed it up. But the problem is today, you know, I'm not saying it's a problem. I'm glad God ain't killed me when I messed up. Amen. But back then, he just dealt with it. I mean, he'd deal with it. I thank God for mercy, but I think sometimes mercy and grace, well, sometimes we trample mercy and grace underneath his feet. We need to be careful. Amen. Boy, I got some kids in here saying, oh, Lord, I'm going to go home. Mom and daddy's going to get me. He said, he knew that they were sinning. He knew that they were making fun of me. In spite of that, he failed to stop them. So I took an oath and made a promise to the family of Eli. I said, the sins of Eli's family will never, listen to this, the sins of Eli's family will never be paid for by bringing sacrifices or offerings. Boy, study that out. See, that's the way their sins were atoned. They would bring their sacrifice to the priest. The priest would take it in and offer the offering or the sacrifice and make it as an offering and offer it to the Lord. So their sins were covered. God says right here that their whole family, they ain't never going to be covered because of sacrifices and offerings. Son, I'd hate to be in that family. I'd be going up to Pawpaw and saying, what'd you do that to me for? Ah, that's funny, but anyway. It says this, Samuel lay down until morning. He lay down till morning. Then he opened up the doors of the Lord's house, and he was afraid to tell the vision, Eli, about the vision he'd received. But Eli called him to him, and he said, Samuel, my son. He called him son. Samuel answered, here am I. Can you imagine how he felt, knowing that he knew what God was getting ready to do, and now Eli's asking him to tell him, Lord, help us. That'd be a tough place to be. He said, what did the Lord say to you, Eli asked. He didn't just stop at that. He said, what did the Lord say? He said, don't hide from me anything he told you. If you do, may God punish you greatly. He was the priest. You remember what he spoke over Hannah happened. She got pregnant. God still used his word and blessed his word at different times. So Samuel told him everything. He didn't hide anything from him. Then Eli said, he is the Lord. Let him do what he thinks is best. You know what I got out of this right here? Eli, the priest, when Samuel told him what God was going to do, how he was going to punish his family, and you never see where he lays out on his face like David did and repents. You never see where Eli ever repented. Never. He didn't get down on his face and say, oh, God, have mercy on my family. Forgive me. I'm so sorry. I'm wrong. No, he said, well, God is God. Let him do what he thinks right. Wow. That's some jacked up stuff, ain't it? Man. As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him. He made everything Samuel said come true. That verse 19 right there is powerful. Every single word Samuel spoke out of his mouth, every prophecy he spoke out of his mouth from the time this happened until he died, every single prophecy he gave come to pass. That's why they were so scared of him. We may get into this later, but they were so scared of Samuel. When he come to town, whatever he said happened. If it says the Moabites are coming, they're going to kill you and take your children, all that, it happened. They were scared of Samuel because he was a man of God. And they knew that God spoke to him. It says every single word he spoke come to pass. So all the people of Israel recognized that Samuel really was a prophet of the Lord. Everyone from Dan all the way to Beersheba knew it. And then listen to this. The Lord continued to appear at Shiloh. Or he continued to appear. The Old Testament says that he came back and made an appearance. So it leads you to believe that because he was doing all that stuff, his presence wasn't even there. How many people are going to church every Sunday, every Wednesday, every time the doors is open, and they don't even allow the presence of God to move? They were going through all these rituals. They was doing everything the Lord had told them to do. They wasn't doing it right. And the presence of the Lord wasn't even there, but they still was going through the rituals. Help us, Jesus. I'm going to be nice. The Lord continued to appear in Shiloh. Listen to this. There he made himself known to Samuel through the messages he gave him. You don't need me to give you a message for you to know who God is. You got your Bible. You got two knees and you got a closet. And if you really want to know who God is and feel His Spirit, go get you some good worship stuff. Get with Tommy or Susie or somebody. They can give you some good worship songs. And you get in the presence of the Lord and you stay there until you hear from Him or you feel Him. How bad do you want it? Come on, let's cut through the chase. How bad do you want the presence of God? We don't have to go to a building to feel the presence of God. As much as I love that we get to come in here now, and this is awesome, look around. I mean, I love it. But if you got to come here to feel God's presence, something's wrong. Because I can promise you this. Everybody read my lips. For the past 2 months or 3 months this has been going on, I've been in God's presence. I don't have to come in here with all of you, as much as I love you and appreciate you, I don't have to come in here to feel God's presence. And if you hadn't felt God's presence in the last 2 months or 3 months this has been going on, I would advise you to hit this altar or get your altar at your house. Go in your closet. I love my office back there. You ain't going to my office. That's my presence, my office, but you can get your own. Amen. And get in the presence of the Lord. It says in chapter 3, verse 1, it says the word of God was scarce because there was nobody to talk to. Now God's raising up a prophet. He's raising up a young man of God, and now it says that God went and spoke to Samuel often, and Samuel gave those words to the people. Do you not know that God needs to speak to you so you can speak to others? Man, there's people all around us that are dying and going to hell. They just want somebody to speak life into them. Quit speaking death. This corona mess has drove me crazy. I don't even turn the trash on, man. I'm so sick of all this stuff. I want to speak life into you, and life more abundantly. Hey, man, God's got life for you, not death. God's for you. He's not against you. Y'all listening? God wants to speak to you. You are a priest. He said that we are a royal priesthood, a peculiar people. Oh, I'll go figure that out. Set apart to the work of the gospel. God wants to speak to you. I'm serious, He does. He wants to speak to you. Spend some time with Him. You ever seen a child, man, neglected? The parents don't spend time with them. They walk by. They just want somebody to talk to. That's why most of the time they start acting out. Not all the time. I acted out and I had all the attention in the world. Amen. Some of us just got a mean streak. I know none of y'all's kids ain't got a mean streak. I know that. Jimmy, when me and you was in church, we got in trouble all the time because we had a little mean streak, didn't we? But I always blame it on the gun boy. What was the gun boy's name? Junior or one. I blame it on one of them Kenny gun. I blamed it on Kenny all the time. I was the mean one. Some of you got a mean streak. Need to pray. I don't know. Ain't nothing wrong with a mean streak as long as you handle it right. I like a little bit of spunk. Amen. Y'all stand with me. Tommy, would you come? Will you do me a favor this week? Get in the presence of the Lord. Okay, get in the presence of the Lord. Let Him speak to you. Get you some good worship music. Get by yourself. Turn your phone off. Boy, I know that's hard for me sometimes, but I do it in my office. I turn my phone off, so I flip my phone over so I don't see everybody blowing my phone up. Just get with the Lord. And listen to me. I know a lot of us have done a lot of bad stuff, but the Lord will forgive you for that stuff, and He'll heal you. He'll minister to you, and then He'll start using you, man. There ain't nothing like being used for God's glory. Amen. Do me a favor. Do me a favor. Everybody do me a favor. Look at your neighbor. And look at your neighbor. I'll stand here all day and say, God wants to use you. Now let Him. Now let Him. Look at him. Look at him saying, now let Him. Let Him. He wants to use you. He loves you. Amen. Amen. Matheson, God wants to use you, brother. He loves you. Jimmy, God wants to use you. Tim, God wants to use you. Sean, God wants to use you. Amen? He wants to use you. Let him. Let him, let him, let him. Hallelujah. Don't bow your heads with me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, that you see us in a way that we don't even see ourselves. God, help us to deal with any sin and things that we got in our life. You're not going to bless that stuff. You said you honor those that honor you, but those that don't honor you, you're not going to honor them. God, I want to be honored, not by men, but by you. So God, as we sing this song, may you minister to your people. Listen, church, if you need to come to this altar's open. Just come and lay it all down. Give it to him. If you got some issues or whatever, if you just want to come down and just worship the Lord and praise the Lord, that's fine too. Or if you need to do that right where you're at. But at this altar call, this is the time for you to get things right with the Lord. If you're not saved, please give your life to Jesus. That's why we came in here, to give your life to Jesus. Guess what? You don't have to make a sacrifice. You are the sacrifice. He said to present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be ye not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. God wants to use you. He wants to set you free so you can help others get free. These altars are open. Let's worship as Tommy and Susie sing.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Come on, church, agree with him.
Who sees
come on. We speak this over you this morning. Receive this word. We speak this over you this morning. Receive it. Favor be upon you. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. I receive it from my family, Lord. My church family, Lord.
May its favor.
Yes. Claim it, church.
The
promise.
Yes.
Come on. Come on, let's give the Lord a clap. Hallelujah. If you said amen to that and you meant it, that means so be it. So be it. Every single blessing that they sang, these words are beautiful. I love this song. Every single blessing is for us. It's the word of God. They're singing the word of God over you. When I come back from Alaska, I had that word from Mark. And that word said that our worship team would begin to prophesy over our church and sing songs to bless our church and to minister to our church and to speak life in our church. And that's what they're doing. And I receive every single word from me and my family and from my church family. Man, we just receive it, Lord. We receive it, Lord. And we claim it in Jesus' name. God, may the Spirit of the living God dwell in us. May you lead, guide, and direct us just like you said you would. May you help us to reach those that others deem unreachable. Help us to love those that others don't love. Help us, Lord, to equip the saints and equip ourselves to do the work of the gospel. And Lord Jesus, help us to be found faithful when you come back, because we know you're coming. And we love you and we give you praise for a great service, Lord, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Hallelujah. Yes. You can be dismissed if you want, or you can hang out. Don't matter to me. We good. Love you guys. See you Wednesday night.